The way you said Austin says truth. The way that you said it has blue around its neck makes me kind of think that you looked at it and you saw that other color. But then again, you paused for a long time. So, oh man, this is tough. I'm going to go with whatever the next person says. So right now it's everybody saying lie. Austin says truth. I'm inclined to say truth. The next person to put one in, I'm going to agree with you no matter what it is, truth or lie, because I'm so split on it. Francis says lie. I'm going to go with lie. Austin, I mean, Carl, show
So,
us your object. Are you telling the truth or you're lying? He's telling the truth. Austin is the only one to get it right. Great job. All right. Well done. Well done. All right. Let's do one more. This is kind of fun. Let's do one more. Look at all the questions and the details. Remember, when we're talking about truth and honesty in our papers, right? We're supposed to include details. All right. Is there someone, one other volunteer who has their object? All right, going once, going twice. All right, we'll call it then. Hey, everybody, I wanted to do that just as a way to just get us to play a little game when we come back from lunch. And I like that too because it makes you think critically. Are they telling the truth? Were you able to? All right, maybe we'll play that game in the future. I enjoy that. Head over to your module, please. And if your name was up there on the screen, ladies and gentlemen, please make sure that you please make sure that you're working on it. Remember that you'll have the whole period to finish that. And tell me in the chat when you're done. And that way I can kind of confirm with you on your screen so that I can take you off the list officially. All right, in our last lesson, we were talking about the Declaration of Independence. Now we kind of got underway with this and excuse me. We were having a pretty good conversation about what this means. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And we said that this is important to us and it's important to future generations. And the thing that made me so proud of you, the thing that made me so happy when I looked at this, is we just kind of had that talk. We just unmuted and look at all of these comments. And I went through, and as I scrolled, like I love some of the stuff that you said. It's just super insightful. Like this, no one can tell me what I can and can't do, and I can't like change who I am. So the idea is that you are, that you are an individual. No one can restrict your right. It's not like, oh, I can just do whatever I want. No, we follow laws, but the idea being that those laws have to be equitable. Yeah, this is really, really, really good stuff. Everyone should have equal rights, no matter how they look or act or even what they believe. The fact that you respect other people's opinions, even if they're different than yours, or even if you think that they're overtly wrong, I think is a very tolerant position to take. So really cool conversation yesterday. And then I was so proud to see that you all put those in. All right, let me put my presentation up for you. The next thing that we did, the next thing is we gave a little bit of information. Yeah, Jimmy, that's fine. Gave a little bit of information about Martin Luther King Jr. And he was in Washington, D.C., and he's giving his famous speech, the I Have a Dream speech, and he's reaffirming in people's minds. He's telling people that they can't forget what our founding fathers wrote. And the words are true. The words are true regardless of what the initial intention was, that all men are created equal, endowed by their creator. King stood on the shoulders of the founding fathers, and he called for consistency to the principles on which America was founded. Then we looked at these images, and you all gave your opinion, and you told me which one you thought was the most powerful. And a lot of people said, image number two was, and I liked image three, and some people liked image six. Is there any connection that you can make to today? Does this remind you of anything that's going on today? I'm going to actually give you the ability to unmute. You don't have to put your hand up. Just be respectful of others and try not to talk over someone.
Unrest. You know, everyone's upset because of things that are going on right now.
Yeah. And so you say, like, you know, the protests were happening in the 60s. There's protests happening 60 years later. You know, in the 2000s. Yeah. Is there any other parallels that you can see, like maybe in their message? Oh, we didn't get this far. Okay. Well, then in that case, I'm sorry, the other class did. Let's number these images across the top, 1, 2, 3, and then across the bottom, 4, 5, 6. You can unmute yourself and tell me, or you could put in the chat, which one of these images stands out to you the most? Which of the images speaks to you? Which one can you connect with the most? The third and fourth one are powerful. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Number three. That's the one that I connected with, was number three. All right. Number six, Andy. And Austin says number one. Hey, Austin or Andy, could you guys, one of you, unmute and tell us, like, what's the connection there? Like, what about it speaks to you or evokes you? Evokes you means, like, makes you feel something or, like, appeals to you. Or Aaliyah or Mariana, any of you is fine. Why did you choose that one? What about it means something to you? I mean, if you just liked the picture, that's one thing, but there's a message in each of these photos. What do you think? You can't be wrong because it's your opinion. Oh man, Austin, that's really, really good. Austin, you said number one. Yeah, let me reiterate his, I love this, it's super insightful. It says in number one, that person in the middle looks like a little kid, you know, like a young girl. And he says things had to have been pretty messed up if it was going to get a little kid to notice. I love that. Yeah, I think that if students are becoming activists, if students are standing up for their rights, then certainly. Another student says, number four, it grabs my attention that they were fighting to be equal and it's about their color. Great. Yeah, segregation is morally wrong is what it says. The last sign say we walk for human dignity. Wow, human dignity. Of course segregation is wrong. And these guys are like, they're protesting it. Now, we can kind of, Carson, when you're finished, you just come on back. Yeah, I love your insights. And this is a difficult conversation or a little bit of an uncomfortable conversation for some people. But remember, you know, since September, we have been building community and we've been building trust in each other. And, you know, these images mean something a little different to me than they might mean to you. Or my experience in my life might have me connect with it in a different way than maybe the way that you feel about it. And I think that that's important for us to realize. And I think that that's important for us to negotiate and think about. And the one thing that I think we can point out here that's really important, especially with what, like Russell said, is going on in the news and in our world today, is that the fight isn't over, right? That there are people that are still marching today. And we're talking about peaceful protests, right? We're talking about people who are, you know, protesting. We're not going to try to like bring in, you know, fringe things and like that, but people who genuinely want, you know, equality and justice. And I think that these images are just as powerful today as they were then, and are a good reminder of where we've come and how much more work we have to do. And here's Jaquel, let me see if I can even get that. I don't know. Oh, no, Jaquel, I can't. There is no password. You have to be logged in with your student, with your school ID. That's the only way that I can give you access. All right. It's not even me giving you access. It's just the way that Newport News has it set up. I can try. I can give you this if I can find it. Let me stop sharing really quick. Yeah, Jaquel, this is the only thing that I have. I'm going to send to you. There's not a password attached to it. Okay. All right. Thank you for your patience, everyone. Yeah. No, that's what I clicked on. There's no password set to the, it literally won't let anybody. Yeah, it won't let anybody in. That's the only thing that I have. So if you're signed in, you should be able to get there. I apologize for any problem that might have caused. Okay, here we go. Get my screen back. Let's go on to the next slide. All right, so this again is from the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident. We've kind of talked about like why this was important. We talked about that yesterday. Now let's see how it applies to us. Here's a paragraph. Now this is Martin Luther King, and we're gonna kind of think about the issue, but at the same time, let's think about how he's writing. We're going to try to be super metacognitive today. Listen to the words that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. wrote and then spoke in his speech. America is essentially a dream as yet unfulfilled. It is a dream of a land where men of all races, of all nationalities, and of all creeds can live together as brothers. The substance of the dream is expressed in these sublime words, words lifted to cosmic proportions. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. This is the dream. One of the first things we notice in this dream is an amazing universalism. It does not say some men, but it says all men. It does not say all white men, but it says all men, which includes black men. It does not say all Gentiles, but it says all men, which includes Jews. It does not say all Protestants, but it says all men, which includes Catholics. All right, what you see in red and blue is the same paragraph from his speech. Look at the first line. Just quickly read it to yourself. What's Martin Luther King Jr. pointing out in his topic sentence? You could put it in the chat if you want to, or if you want to unmute, you can do that too. I like to hear. The question one more time is, what is Martin Luther King pointing out in his topic sentence? Okay, he wants everyone to get along. Well, that's definitely true about his paragraph. Well, here's a little hint. Remember, his topic sentence will be his first sentence. What is he pointing out right here, just in this little part? you know, equality is part of the paragraph. You aren't wrong. But if we're just honing in on the very first topic sentence. Okay, I cut out for just a minute, but you said that the dream is not completed, right? Yeah, that dreams can be achieved, but this dream, and I'm going off of what Francis says and what Andy says and then Naeem's comment, yeah, that the dream is not yet completed. The dream can be achieved, but it is still not a reality. I love that. Well done. Okay, so what we call this is a claim. Martin Luther King is making a claim. He says America is essentially a dream, but it's not finished yet. The dream is not real. Not yet. Now let's move into the second part. It's a dream of a land where all men, where men of all races, of all nationalities, and of all creeds can live together as brothers. The substance of the dream is expressed in these sublime words, words lifted to cosmic proportions. In the second part, he describes the American dream, and then he inserts that blue section from the Declaration of Independence. Why did he do that? What was the author's purpose for including the Declaration of Independence as part of his speech? Okay, it is the rights, and it does contain, you know, this idea of rights and freedoms of people. But why this? Why did he pick that? Why didn't he tell a personal story? Why did he choose the Declaration of Independence? He could have, I'm not teaching religion, but I would tell you, he was a pastor. Martin Luther King was a preacher, and he could have certainly quoted a church document, or he could have quoted a Bible passage, I'm sure. But why did he choose to use the Declaration of Independence? Think about when you write. Remember, we had the aces, and then I showed you the ice paragraph. This right here. Oh. This part right here, this is our topic sentence. So this is the I, right? For introduce the topic. This is the C for cite an example. Okay, because he believed in equality, that's true. I think he put it in the Declaration of Independence because it says that all men are created equal. Yeah, that's good. But I'm sure he could find, he could have told a story, or why didn't he just say, all men are created equal because I believe it, and those 10 people over there believe it. Why did he pick a document like the Declaration? I mean, I'm looking for something really specific. You are saying correct things, but we have to remember, he's an author, and the author does things on purpose. The author purposely picks the words he chooses. He purposely picked the Declaration of Independence. Why is that a good example? Maybe that's what I'm asking. I mean, you're going to be meta here. Okay, meta is when you're thinking about thinking. Why did he choose the Declaration? Who's his audience? Like, who's going to hear his speech? Okay, us in the future, and we are the people, and the people of what? The people of Australia? The people of, now you're getting it. Uh-huh. Yes, you're correct. All right, keep putting more. The people of, well, actually, Andy, you're actually correct too there. Yeah, the people of the United States, the U.S., Americans. Americans are the ones that are going to be hearing this. So why did he cite an example from the Declaration? Because it's an American document. It's a legal document. Did you know that? It was actually formally sent to King George in England to tell him, we need, you know, no taxation without representation. You remember all of that? He cites an example that will back up his main argument. So I'm going to circle this. Maybe. There we go. This backs up his topic sentence. Great work. All right, let's move into the last part. Now, if he says America is essentially a dream unfulfilled, the Declaration says all men are created equal. If he just ended it there, he would have been correct, but he would not have been as impactful. He would have not been as powerful a speaker. Instead, he comes down here and he completes the E part of the ICE paragraph. This is what he says. This is the dream. One of the first things we notice in this dream is an amazing universalism. It doesn't say some men, it says all men. Okay, so now, what is he... He's elaborating even more down here. Why? So he introduced his topic. He cited his example. Now he's elaborating or explaining the example. Why does he do that? This is not as hard as the last question. Why does Martin Luther King bother to explain his example? Great. So that people will better understand. Yes. So that readers will, I love that. They all came in. They're all coming at the same time. Yeah. So that readers will understand what he's trying to say through his example. Yes. To give more detail. I love it. Specific details. You remember in your prompts, it says include specific details and examples. These are specific details. For example, it says up here in his example, all men are created equal. I guess I should probably change my highlighter to a different color. Let's change it to light blue. Nope, that's the color of the text. That would be a disaster. Let's change it to the green color. Okay. He says right here that all men are created equal. Then he goes on to list examples or to further flesh this out, to explain. It says all men. Not just all white men, but it says all men, which includes black men. He doesn't say just all Gentiles. It says all men, which includes Jewish people. It does not say all Protestants. It says all men, which includes Catholics. You see that? If you look at just the highlighted words, it's kind of silly, isn't it? Not really. I'm not saying that his speech is silly, but what I'm saying is it seems very simplified. Do you remember when I told you that when you all write, you should pretend that I'm an idiot? Well, maybe you don't have to pretend, but you should think of me as an idiot when I'm reading your paper, that I don't know anything. This is exactly what we're telling you to do. Give us very, very fine details, very specific, exact, precise details. All right. Awesome. I love your input. I love what you have to say. All right, let's dig a little bit deeper. Let's go on to the next thing. Look at these words that are in red here. What does sublime, cosmic, and universalism, what do these three vocabulary words do for you? What do these three words make you think of? What kind of image do they create? And you could just pop it in the chat, that's fine. Oh, good. All right. Let me ask that question then. In the word universalism, what word do you see? What root word do you see in there? Good. Yeah, universe and cosmic. Don't those have like, yeah, well done. Don't those have like those big ideas, those big lofty ideas? If something is a cosmic idea, if it's a universal idea, it actually kind of makes me feel like if I don't agree with it, maybe there's something wrong with me. Maybe I'm on the outside. Maybe if this is universally accepted, if all people understand it and I don't understand it, then maybe there's something going on with my thinking. Awesome. So the author uses words like sublime and cosmic and universal to create this image of power, of just power, of justice. All right. Awesome. Okay, unity. Now, these are a couple of definitions for you to know, and you'll have these on your in your module. Unity within a paragraph. I'm not talking about like freedom and peace and unity. I'm talking about when you write. So like when you're typing, we say your essay is unified. What we mean by that is that your paragraph is just about one main topic. That's it. All the sentences support the topic. All the sentences talk about the topic. There are the topic sentences, there's the example sentence, and then there's the details, okay? And then sometimes you're going to use concluding sentences or summary sentences. But regardless, they're always going to come back to this one main topic. And in his topic, he was talking about dream, all right? So direction. We talk about, does your paragraph have direction? It means that it has a strong topic sentence. If it has unity, that means that all of the sentences are tied back into the main point, back into that topic sentence. Coherence means that the ideas in the paragraph are logically connected. Think about Martin Luther's flow real quick. He started with, America is a dream. And then underneath that, he said, the dream is equality. Look at the Declaration of Independence. We don't have that yet. And he says, when we look at the Declaration, we're reminded that all men are equal, like this kind and this kind and this kind and this kind. Coherence is that he doesn't just say, the Declaration of Independence says, no, he makes his claim. It's all in order. It has transitions. And then lastly, support means that the paragraph contains specific and detailed discussion on the ideas in the topic sentence. And we saw that when he was going through all the different types of people. Okay, so here's what you're going to remember. This part right here. You got to have a topic sentence. It's the first thing. Then you have supporting sentences. We call these like examples, right? And then we have a concluding sentence or sentences. This is where we loop back and explain the example. Right. That's the part where you go, Mr. Mitzel doesn't know anything. All right. Now, I want you to go back to the module. This is the part where you're going to have a, okay, discard that, where you're going to have a chance here to work on your own. All right. Let's click next in the module. You're looking for the thing called just, oops, that's the text. You're looking for the thing called You Be the Judge. All right, go ahead and open that up. Now, I'm going to give you time on the timer, but then I'm going to go over the answers with you. So it's important for you to have something for us to talk about. Okay, there are three items right here. At the top of the screen, you're going to see you click on the blue button. It says Submit Assignment to open the text box. Yeah, Javiana, that's fine. I would suggest copying and pasting these into the text box, and then you're just going to answer underneath them, okay? So the first one says, the paragraph shows unity. All the sentences reflect back to the topic sentence at the beginning of the paragraph. How does it show unity? Like, what words in the text, what words in this paragraph are linked back? Okay, does that make sense to you? You're going to investigate. You're actually looking for quotes that link the ideas. So you're not going to tell me like Martin Luther King was like all about freedom and justice and equality, and he lived that in his daily. You're not telling me that. I want you to tell me this paragraph shows unity because it has this word, or it uses this idea in the first sentence, in the example, and then in the explanation. All right, I'm going to set your timer. I'll give you the last class took about 8 minutes. I think I'm going to give you 6, and then I'll take a look at your screen at the same time. This seems a little bit difficult, but it isn't. It's truly not difficult at all. And in fact, when we go and do the go over the first one, you'll think it's pretty easy. All right, I'm going to play a little bit of music. Sure, I can explain a little bit better. Let me pause this. Okay. Let me pull mine up. Let me model the first one for you. Okay, so right here's the question, or here's the idea. The paragraph shows unity. All the sentences relate back to the topic sentence because they have the word the dream, or they refer to the dream. Martin Luther King shows unity throughout his paragraph by talking about the dream. He does it in the topic sentence and the example. Oh, actually, I'm going to change this. I'm going to say through the topic sentence, the example, and that capital and is just for you, and the explanation. Okay, and I can prove it. I can go up here. Oops. I have to shrink it down. I'll put that back up on the screen so you can copy it and get that answer now. He says it's a dream yet unfulfilled. Then in the explanation, he says the substance of the dream is expressed in these words. And then in the closing part, or the explanation, he says this is the dream. So he shows unity in each section by talking about the dream. Does that explain it a little bit better? Okay, thank you. Awesome, I'm glad. So then number two is a slightly different question, but it's the same thing. The paragraph shows consistency. How does Martin Luther King show consistency? And I would like you to focus in on this. There are good transitions used in the paragraph. So you might say, Martin Luther shows, King shows consistency by using these transition words. And then you will list the transition words that you find. Okay. And I'll put your timer back up. And then I'll put the music back on. Thank you for asking for that clarification. Stepped away and you just came back. You're filling out the "You Be the Judge" section. I did the first one with us. There we go. I want you to look back at his speech. How did he show unity? Well, in the first part, he talked about the dream. He talks about it throughout the topic sentence, in the example, and in the explanation. The next one is, how does he show consistency? There are lots of good transition words. What were the transition words that he used? So you'll write, he shows consistency by using these transition words, and then you can list them. Oh, definitely. You can write mine. Certainly. You can write mine. There's three altogether.
As we reopen,